We have some announcements. Today we'll be collecting for the Deacon's Fund during the last hymn, so please stay seated for the first verse. Food pantry needs soup, instant potatoes, pasta, tomato sauce, baked beans, dish soap. And if you wish to contribute money to the food pantry, make a check payable to Anescafal Food Pantry, or you can do cash, see Linda. The food pantry needs yours. IPH still needs men's jeans, personal items, toothpaste, feminine products, small size undergarments, and they're always in need of towels, blankets, and bed linens. Use clean clothing if acceptable. You can bring the donations to church, leave them in a box out in the Norfax, marked IPH, Sandy Conley graciously delivers them. Okay, IPH meal, we have the main meal, August 27th. IPH sign-up sheet for items needed is in the desk in the Norfolk. The meal will be prepared here next Sunday,
yes.
Correct? The 25th, so if you need help with this, see Maria, it's right there. The First Church in Albany holds a centering prayer every Wednesday at noon, and it's good to focus on your connection to God, find peace in your spiritual journey through life. It's a good way to strengthen your prayer muscles, is what they say, and it's hosted by the Reverend Dr. Marshawna Walston. It's a very good minister, so we'll probably enjoy it. Bible study will be starting August 31st at 10 a.m. It'll be a study of the book of James. If you consider attending, please sign up the sheet in the Narthex. See Carrie. It's a great time for fellowship and opportunity for spiritual growth. And Carrie's phone number is in the book.
All are welcome.
All are welcome. Knox and Thompson Lake are invited all the congregations to attend a worship service and lunch at Thacker or Park Lane, Glen Doom Pavilion on September 1st. That's the first pavilion on the right as you come into the park coming up the hill. There's a $6 fee for parking. There's an upper and a lower parking lot. There's a lot of parking. If you're a veteran, the fee's waived. Just so you know that. Clarksville Historic Society will hold their first fall program September 4th at 7. The program's on the Albany Rural Cemetery. Interesting items in the oddities at the cemetery. Jordan Lindley will be holding the First Harvest Festival September 14th. Here at the church, be open from 11 to 5, and additional information is in your bulletin. Also that day, September 14th, Anescafal Reform is celebrating their 200th anniversary. And worship, praise, music, food, much more, see the flyer in the Norfolk. So, any other announcements? Oh, there's a worship meeting after worship service today. Let's turn to prayer concerns. We have still a big prayer list in your bulletin. By Diane's out in the Norfolk. Hi, Diane. It's nice to see you. We're praying for you. And Roger, it's very nice to see you. Don't be scared of me like this, huh? All right.
I'm back.
No, you're still here. Keep the family of Gary Van Alstyne in your prayers. He passed away August 16th. The Van Alstyne and umbrellas. And the Martins family who lost their home and their vehicles due to a fire a couple weeks ago. So, any others? In that case, let's go to worship knowing our help is in the name of the Lord.
Dan.
Danny's
name.
Right, right.
Danny.
Danny. He's just turning 50. Many more. Let us pray. God of holy wisdom, we are seekers on the way to a deeper wisdom and a wider vision. Our lives are full of information and opinions, but in the midst of it all, we long to hear the voice of wisdom. Your wisdom, God, cutting through the noise and teaching us how to live. God, we have come here this morning to learn wisdom from your word, from your Holy Spirit, and from one another. We have come so that wisdom may call us out of the darkness and into the light. We have come to have the deeper, richer, wisdom-filled life that you have promised for each one of us. Oh God, make us ready to hear the words spoken to our hearts this morning. Call us to hear your wisdom and grant us the courage to respond. In Jesus' name, amen. Please join me in the call of worship found in your bulletin. Who among you is seeking the wisdom of God?
We long to hear God's words spoken to our hearts.
Who among you is seeking God's bright and holy truth?
We long to learn the ways of wisdom and righteousness.
Who among you is speaking a spirit-filled life?
We long to live life in holiness and light.
God grants wisdom generously to all who ask.
Come near, people of God. Let us worship in wisdom and truth.
Amen. Our hymn is What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Number 435. We know we shouldn't do it, holy places. We know it is wrong, but we distinguish between us and them. We know we have nothing to fear, but turn aside from God's strong love. Let us confess together all we have done to hurt each other and hurt others. Let us trust such a God with our prayer of confession found in your bulletin. How nonchalantly we say we trust you, Holy One, and how quickly our fear silences our words. We find you at the side of the poor while we cozy up to the rich and famous. You stand behind the counter serving the hungry in the soup kitchen while we are stocking our freezers and pantries till they overflow. We'll look down on those whose hands are dirty, but your hand of mercy pulls them into your embracing love. Forgive us, O Lord, and do good for us when we have trouble doing good for others. Surround us with your love. Surround us with your grace. Surround us with your peace. Surround us with the Spirit of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Be strong, do not fear. God comes to fill our parched souls with living water, to open our eyes to the grace which is ours. God comes for no other reason than to save us. This is indeed the good news. Thanks be to God. And knowing we are forgiven, how are we to live? Our Lord said on the night he was betrayed, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this everyone will know you are my disciples if you love one another." Thank you. Let us pray. Father God, teach us how to dance to the rhythm of your wisdom. Show us how to laugh with the insights of your truth, so that we can live for the praise of your glory in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Today, I chose two scriptures, one from Proverbs, the wisdom of Solomon, chapter 9, and one from the Gospel of John, chapter 6. Proverbs 9, wisdom has built her house. She has set up its seven pillars. She has prepared her meat and mixed her wine. She has also set her table. She has sent out her servants, and she calls from the highest point of the city, let all who are simple come to my house. To those who have no sense, she says, come, eat my food and drink the wine I have mixed. Leave your simple ways and you will live. Walk in the way of insight. And from the Gospel of John, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Then the Jews began to argue sharply among themselves. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is real food, and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors ate manna and died, but whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And our hymn is Love Divine, number 92.
Thank you.
Lord, may the words. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of our heart, be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Today there was a verse from Proverbs and a verse from the Gospel of John, which will be the focus of our attention this morning. From the first reading, leave your simple ways and you will live. Walk in the way of insight. And from John, I am the living bread, which comes down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, they will live forever. And the bread which I shall give them for the life of the world is my flesh. Putting these two verses together then means walking in wisdom or insight, is being in Christ, partaking of the living bread from heaven. The word insight in the first lesson means wisdom, or the power of forming a sound judgment in any matter, or understanding. Then being in Christ is the wisest way to walk in the world. But how can one be in Christ and we with him as the first lesson partakes from his table, eat and drink from Christ, the feast he has prepared for us at the same time? One day a minister and his son were walking down the beach. The boy had just been questioning his father about a recent sermon about Christ dwelling in his people. The boy said, "Dad, I cannot understand how Christ can live in us and we live in him at the same time." As they walked further down the beach, the father noticed an empty bottle with a cork in it laying on the sand. Taking the bottle, he half filled it with water, recorked it, and flung it into the ocean. Then he said, "Son, the sea is in the bottle, and the bottle is in the sea. As it bobs up and down in the sea, it is a picture of life in motion, life in Christ." We are in Christ, and Christ is in us, and all around us at the same time. And a wise person recognizes that reality of life and lives with it and in it. But sadly, our culture seeks wisdom as something else, as fame, as wealth, as glory, as someone to look up to. Who are our heroes today? Rock stars, baseball players, football players, basketball players, movie stars, people with fame and fortune, with wealth. The wise today are not seen for their insight, their intuition, their discerning knowledge of life. Not the wise, the heroes, the one the world looks up to, are the wealthy, the famous in the sport world, not the peace advocate, not the Nobel Prize winner, not the researcher who's looking for a cure for cancer. I would venture to guess that if you ask a dozen people, who is Desmond Tutu? Is not half, maybe even one could tell me, he was a Nobel Prize winner and the bishop of the combined churches in Namibia. But if you ask someone, who is LeBron James or Madonna or Taylor Swift or Bruce Springsteen, I bet everyone has some idea of who they are. A basketball player and a bunch of rock singers. The following shows how our culture is so interested in fame and wealth and has truly, truly lost the meaningful way one should live. A legend says a man asked God, "What does $1 billion mean to you who are powerful?" "Hardly a penny," God says. Then the man asked God, "What are 1,000 centuries to you?" God answered, "Hardly a second." Well, thinking he had God backed into a corner, the man then said, "Then if that's the case, oh Lord, give me a penny." "In a second," God replied. Wisdom isn't outsmarting God. Wisdom is living in and with God. Wisdom is being in Christ and surrounded by Christ. Wisdom is eating and drinking from this feast which God has prepared for us. Wisdom to God is living in a relationship with Him, being able to eat and drink from God's table, being able to accept and rejoice in His forgiveness and the new life which was given to us by the way He died on the cross. Wisdom means being with God, coming into His house to take in all that God has so freely given us. Coming into His house in this day and age means coming to church so that we may stay in a relationship with God, that we may be wise, that we may be filled with God's wisdom. Barbara Brookhoff says in her book she wrote, Faith Alive, the happy hour for the Christian should be the hour of worship on Sunday morning. But the question is, how do you honestly feel when you're awakened by the alarm on the Lord's Day and you realize it's another church day? Can you hardly wait for the service time to roll around? Or do you roll over in bed, moan and groan and cover your head and wish that once again, maybe like last Sunday, the one before, we could or just sleep in and forget the whole boring, time-consuming thing? Is the thought of worship agony or ecstasy? But think about it this way. We're coming to meet God, not just anybody, but God. Should the delightful suspense of worship make our breath short and our hearts beat faster? One professor said in seminary, God is a God who is everywhere, but He has to be somewhere. And that somewhere is here in this house on Sunday mornings. Being in Christ, having the true wisdom of Christ, means participating in Christ and with Christ. And that happens to the fullest extent in worship in God's house. Sure, God can be found in nature, on the golf course, or feeding the livestock, but the fullest revelation, the fullest view, the best picture we see of God is here in His house on Sunday after Sunday as we hear His word and partake in His meal, as we witness through baptism the growth of His kingdom, as we join together in prayer and meditation, and meditate upon His word, read, and hear it preached. The word liturgy, our church's liturgical, means we follow a standard order of worship. The word liturgy means work of the people. We come to church and work of praise to God. But honestly, how many of us really work at praising God? How many of us are here of the true delight to praise God and work in song, prayer, and meditation upon His word? Do we really work at worship and praise? Or do we let the wisdom of the world invade this hour with God also? Are we sitting there thinking about other things? Are we checking our cell phones? Are we thinking about maybe a football game or a round of golf? Or how the roast in the oven is doing? Or how we're going to get our pet who is sick healthy? Or how good the weather is going to be? Are you thinking about next week and all the work that has to be done? Are you worshiping God with your entire being, your mind, your heart, and your soul? Jesus says that we are to love your God with all our heart, all our minds, and all our soul, and all our strength. Can't we even love him 1 hour a week with our whole being instead of being concerned whether the sermon will be too long or will we get out of church 2 or 3 minutes later than usual? Being in Christ means being in the joy, the thrill, the ecstasy of his presence with no matter to all the other stuff in the world. When you have found the joy and thrill of being in Christ, worship becomes more than a duty. It becomes a royal work of praising and thanking God for all the great gifts we have received. Worship becomes not just standing around doing nothing, but being involved with one's whole being, mind, heart, and soul. Coming to worship is a royal work of eating and drinking from the living bread and living water. Coming to worship is being totally in Christ. And then when we are in Christ, we live for Christ. This act of being in Christ, this act of worship, then makes a difference in our daily lives. It gives a purpose, a direction, and a guide for our lives. As we live in Christ, that makes life rich and full. Full of wisdom, not in a worldly sense, but in the sense that we are rich in a relationship with Christ, day in and day out. Worship being in Christ then sets the tone for the rest of the week. As we live for Christ out in this world. Can you recognize the person in this story? For years, this person goes to church, listens to the preacher, manages to pray now and then, and gives a dutiful offering. For years, this person thinks their faith is pretty good because no one checks up on them. No one demands much time. No one makes them strip away the mask to examine their spiritual life. No one has challenged their own ideas of what religion and Christianity is all about. A certain amount of comfort comes along now and then, and this person feels much better about his life. Now and then, certain needs arise within the church. Sunday school teachers, committees, projects, etc. But someone always steps in to feel the need. Once in a while, a preacher will say something that strikes a raw nerve, but long ago they tabled these raw nerve messages as guilt trips, and they refuse to go on them again. Finally, the person hears these words of Jesus, "Eat my flesh, drink my blood, or die." What Jesus said was, "Eat his flesh, drink his blood, and live." It only makes sense when the negative is heard. Our person in the story begins to sense the seriousness of worship, the finality of this life, the wonder of purpose, magic of faith, the possibility and demands for service, and can admit it, if only to themselves, "God, I'm hungry, I'm starving to death. Feed me, Lord, lest I die." Are we being fed here so that we can go out into the world and be with Christ? Are we starving enough to admit to Christ we need his body and his blood? We need his living bread? Are we starving enough to admit that we all need more than a superficial relationship with Christ, where we only go through the motions, but never really eat or drink from the living bread and water? Are we starving enough that in this worship hour, we sense we are truly in the presence of Almighty God? And in that presence, we stand condemned, sentenced to death and hell. But because of his Son, we have been free from that sentence to live and through Christ. Are we starving enough to return again next week? Because to continue that relationship with Christ. We want, because we have found the joy, the richness, the pleasure of being in and with Christ. The question is, how starving are we? And in that relationship with Christ, have we responded to His gracious love in our lives? Have we taken but not given? As we live with Christ out in the world, Paul says we are to make the most of the time by doing the will of the Lord. Our Christianity does not stop when we walk out these doors, but it continues day in and day out as we respond to our neighbor, be that your spouse, or your children, or your mother or father, the person next door, the person down the road, or the person across the seas. Our relationship that we establish over and over again each Sunday in Christ in worship allows us to live with Christ out in the world, where because Christ responded to the needs of those around Him, He has challenged us all to do the same. I have a final story this morning. Stories about a man called Old Ben Putnoff examining himself to see if we and Old Ben aren't the same, and hopefully we are all different. Ben Putnoff was a member of the Lord's Church. Morally, he was a good man. He didn't lie. He didn't curse. He didn't drink. He didn't beat his wife. He didn't smoke. He paid his income tax. Came to church on Sunday and went to Sunday school, paid his bills, and gave a few leftover bucks to the Lord. He never opposed anything that was good. But one day, Old Ben Putnoff died and stood before the righteous judge. The judge said, "Ben, you are charged with trying to close the church. Are you guilty or not guilty?" "Not guilty," pleaded Ben Putnoff. "I didn't do a thing." "Guilty as charged," the judge ruled. Then the judge continued, "Ben, you have confessed the most effective way ever devised of closing the church, the kingdom of God. You didn't do a thing. You didn't visit the sick. You didn't encourage the weak. You didn't feed the hungry. You didn't welcome strangers among you. You didn't care for the well-being of those in your community of faith by praying for or with them. You didn't reach out to the lost with the gospel. You didn't reach out to anyone. But judge, but Almighty God," Ben pleaded, "I intended to do all those things, but I was too busy making a living and enjoying myself and my family, my friends, my way of life. I had just been putting it off." Let us pray. Dear God, lead us on the path to discovering everlasting joy, a joy that transcends fleeting moments and remains steadfast in the face of life's ups and downs. Grant us the wisdom to recognize that true joy does not depend on external circumstances, but is a wellspring that flows from the heart, connected to your divine presence. May we find joy not only in times of celebration, but also in moments of challenge, knowing that your guidance lights the way to a joy that endures forever. Amen. We now confess what we believe by the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He arose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. as we continue responding to God by giving of our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
your people, as you have opened the generosity of our hearts, may these gifts be a blessing for use in your kingdom. May you shine the light for others, bring peace throughout the world, peace through chaos. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Friends in Christ, God invites us to hold the needs of our sisters and brothers as dear to us as our own needs. Loving our neighbors as ourselves, we offer our thanksgiving and our petitions on behalf of the church and the world. Eternal God, you have been our resting place throughout the ages. Generations come and pass away, but you abide forever. We praise you for your presence among us. You bring us comfort amid our trials, clarity where confusion persists, peace in the midst of conflict, hope of eternal life. Hear us now as we pray for your church and the needs of the world. For you are the God of our lives. We pray for the Church of Jesus Christ that begun, maintained, and promoted by the Holy Spirit, it may be true, engaging, glad, and active, doing your will. Let your church be always faithful, O God, and ready to promote the cause of compassion and love and peace. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. We pray that everywhere upon the earth, there may be justice and peace. We pray especially today for the well-being of people in parts of the world affected by drought and famine. We continue to pray for peace in the Ukraine and Israel. Lord, we pray for all people in their daily life and work, for our families and friends and neighbors, and for those who are alone. We name before you individuals and families experiencing personal hardship or facing an uncertain future, those who are separated from loved ones, those who grieve this day, and those who are sick in the hospital or ill at home. Hear us, Lord, as we now lift up those people and those situations you have placed upon our hearts. We pray for the family of Gary Van Alstyne in his passing. We pray for the Marks family that lost their home due to a fire. We pray for Rogersman and Jim Riley and Bob Goodman and Diane Larroy, Pastor Morgan and her family, Pastor Morgan's granddaughter Tara, Darlene Stanton, Reba Meiser, Kevin Chill, Ronnie Van Hoosen's great-grandson Julie, Maria's co-worker Holly, his husband John, Sean has lung cancer, Bill Rossman, and we pray for David's brother Mike recovering from his recent heart surgery. We pray for this church and this community. Hear us, Lord. Lord, in your love, hear all our